I want to welcome you to our first Advent service. So glad that you could gather with us wherever you are. For Advent is a really special time of the year. It's always been special to me, Graham, and as a Lutheran boy growing up in South Dakota, Advent was always very, very special. But when Joni and I came to Wonderful Mercy Church, we discovered the traditions here were pretty special as well. So maybe you'd want to say a little bit about that, how that came to be.
Well, unlike you, I'm not a good Lutheran boy. I was a Baptist boy, not a particularly good one at that. And we did not observe Advent. We didn't pay attention to the church calendar in the churches that I was a part of growing up. So the first time I had exposure to the observance and the celebration of Advent was here at Nativity Lutheran Church, which was our name those many years ago. And we did, at that time, midweek Advent services, and then we had special Sunday emphases during Advent.
Right.
And I was free at that time to work with those Advent services in such a way that they were interesting and engaging. And I approached it from the perspective of what would I enjoy? And so from that came a combination of Christmas carols and of storytelling and of celebrating the Lord's Supper, which is a beautiful part of what we do in our midweek services.
Yes, I'm so glad that that's a part of it. You know, as you know, and as people at Wonderful Mercy know, the Lord's Supper is a very special sacrament in my life, and the fact that we're going to have it in the context of this service, I think, is great.
And this is a great chance to remind you and to invite you to get the elements ready for your family or your friends, whoever you're watching with, to get something put together for you to be able to receive communion, whether it's water or juice, bread, crackers, whatever it is. We'll be observing the Lord's Supper in just a moment.
Yes.
And with that, Pastor Lee, why don't you open us with prayer, and then we will step into this first midweek Advent worship experience.
Okay, we'll do. Lord, as we gather together on this evening, we ask you, Lord, that you would bless our preparations. This is a time of expectation, of preparation. And we do that knowing that you love us, that you've always loved us, and you have much in store for us as we prepare for the coming of Jesus, even as he has already come to us. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Pastor Lee. Well, let's turn now to the first scripture reading of our worship experience this evening. It's an Old Testament reading from Psalm 126. And now, God, do it again. Bring rains to our drought-stricken lives, so those who planted their crops in despair will shout hurrahs at the harvest. So those who went off with heavy hearts will come home laughing with armloads of blessing.
And now let's move to the gospel lesson for today. It is from Luke chapter 1, and this is what has often been called the Magnificat from Mary. I'm dancing the song of my Savior God. God took one good look at me, and look at what happened. I'm the most fortunate woman on earth. What God has done for me will never be forgotten. The God whose very name is holy, set apart from all others. His mercy flows in wave after wave on those who are in awe before him. He bared his arm and showed his strength, scattered the bluffing braggarts. He knocked tyrants off their high horses, pulled victims out of the mud. The starving poor sat down to a banquet. The callous rich were left out in the cold. He embraced his chosen child, Israel. He remembered and piled on the mercies, piled them high. It's exactly what he promised, beginning with Abraham and right up to now.
Oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations by, in one the hearts of all mankind. Bid thou our sad division cease, and be thyself our King of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, come to thee, O Israel.
I invite you to join us now in our litany for Advent. And Pastor Lee, I have to say that this is also one of the high points for me of these special Advent services, are the liturgical pieces in it, because I grew up in a tradition that was non-liturgical. The most that we had were responsive readings, which you could find at the back of the Baptist hymnal. And those were lovely. But I find that these litanies and liturgies really add a depth to my experience in these worship services.
Yeah, beautiful, thoughtful words, often poetic in their nature, and bringing us all together in reading them.
Yes. So let's all together engage now in the litany for Advent. Like the cities of old, may the ruins of our lives become the foundation
upon which a monument to your love is built.
Testimony to grace upon mercy upon grace.
Slowly, stone by stone, build us into witnesses unafraid to take a stand.
For those who feel the heavy boot of oppression upon their soul.
For those with wounded hearts.
For those whose human rights are threadbare.
Slowly, stone by stone, build us into community with overflowing hospitality.
For those who live on the margins of any society.
For those too frightened to risk relationship again.
For each and every human and all of creation.
That we might journey to the manger together.
Where our weariness becomes laughter and our skepticism becomes joy.
At the sight of the Lord.
Let's pray. God of all hope, give us faith sufficient to risk everything on this journey. Help us be willing to give it all away in order to follow you. Assist us in removing the masks of our lives and becoming authentic persons with a passion for your people and your world. This we ask in the name of Jesus, the most real person of all.
Amen.
Here in this dusty ground, I bow with kings, where wise men laid before their offering. I lay no golden crown here at your feet, just this my broken life I offer thee. You are the God of the broken, the friend of the weak. You wash the feet of the weary, embrace the ones in need. And I want to be like you, Jesus, to have this heart in me. You are the God of the humble. You are the humble King. Oh, kneel me down again here at your feet. Show me how much you love humility. Oh, Spirit, be the star that leads me to the humble heart of love I see in you. You are the God of the broken, the friend of the weak. You wash the feet of the weary, embrace the ones in. I want to be like you, Jesus, to have this heart in me. You are the God of the humble. You are the humble King. You are the God. Have this heart in me. You are the God of the humble. You are the humble King. Oh, you are the God of the humble. You are the humble King.
Let's move now to a time of communing with the Lord and with one another in the Lord's Supper. Advent is a time of preparation. Advent is a time when we will often in the church hear the words, "Come, Lord Jesus." In the Lord's Supper, Lord Jesus comes to us in his real presence to nurture us and to feed us with his love and presence and grace. And so now as we prepare to join together wherever we are in this time of communion, Let's hear the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples as he gathered them around his table and offered himself to them in this sacrament. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And in the same way also, he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Come, Lord Jesus, come. In this Advent season, we joyfully call out to you. Amen.
One of the most beloved traditions within our Advent services midweek and Christmas Eve is the reading of a story that takes us into the season of Advent. And over the years, I suppose I've probably read about 100 different stories. This is one of my favorite. A Christmas Ballad for the Captain by William J. Lederer. Captain Elias Stark, commanding officer of our destroyer, was a square-shouldered New Hampshire man, as quiet and austere as the granite mountains of his native state. About the only time the enlisted men heard him talk was when they first reported aboard. He would invite them to his cabin for a one-minute speech of welcome, then question them about their families and note the names and addresses of the sailors next of kin. That was the way he had first met the unholy K's, Krakow, Kratch, Koenig, and Kelly. They had arrived with a draft of 17 men from the naval prison at Portsmouth, New Hampshire. Most of the prison group were bad eggs, but the worst were these four sailors from a small coal mining town in Pennsylvania. They had chests and shoulders like buffaloes, fists like sledgehammers, black stubble beards, and manners to match. They had once been good kids, the mainstays of St. Stephen's Choir in their hometown, but somehow they had gone astray. They seemed to specialize in getting into trouble together as a quartet. All four went into the Navy direct from reform school. Within 6 months, they were in serious trouble again and had been sent to Portsmouth Naval Prison. When they were called to the captain's cabin, they listened to his speech with exaggerated expressions of boredom. Then the old man broke out his record book to note the names and addresses of their next of kin. He looked up inquiringly. Krakow, the leader of the unholy K's, took the initiative. Spreading his tremendous arms, he pulled Kelly, Kratch, and Koenig into a tight circle. "The four of us, sir, ain't got no family. We ain't got parents or wives or relatives." He paused. "All we got is girlfriends, eh, fellas?" Captain Stark simply puffed on his pipe. Patiently, he asked, "Would you give me your best ladies' names and addresses for our records?" The unholy K's glanced at one another. Krakow said, "Sir, we don't feel like it's an officer's business who our girls are." He stopped as Kelly tugged his sleeve and whispered to him. "Okay," continued Krakow sarcastically,
You want to know who our best gals are? I'll tell you. Mine's Rita Hayworth. Kelly's is Ginger Rogers. Cratch's is Lana Turner. And Koenig's is Paulette Goddard. They all got the same address. Hollywood, sir.
Very well, said the captain. I will list those names in my records. Thank you. That will be all. As soon as the unholy K's got below deck, they began bragging how they had made a fool out of the old man. Kelly started a bawdy song, and Krakow Cratch and Koenig joined in. Each man in turn made up a lyric while the other three harmonized. They had splendid voices, and with their choir boy training, they formed a wonderful quartet. They sang four unprintable verses about the captain and why he wanted their girls' addresses. Actually, the captain had a good reason for obtaining personal information about the men. He strongly believed it was his duty to keep their families informed on how they were getting along. So once every 3 months, in blunt New England fashion, he sent a personal note, written in a tiny, neat hand to everyone's next of kin. For example, "Dear Madam, your son John is well and is happy as can be expected in North Atlantic gales. If he shaved more often and cleaned his clothes more meticulously, he would be more popular with his division chief. I think highly of him as a gunner's mate, and with luck, you should see him in a few months. You will find that he has put on 12 pounds, and the extra flesh hangs well on him. Sincerely, Elias Stark, Commander, U.S. Navy." In September, after a year in the combat zone, our destroyer went to the Brooklyn Navy Yard for a three-week overhaul. Almost all the officers and men went home on furloughs. Only the old man stayed on board the entire time, working alone, day and night. No one knew the nature of his apparently urgent business, but whenever we passed his cabin, we saw him hunched over his desk, scratching away with an old-fashioned pen, while his cherrywood pipe sent up clouds of blue smoke. We were puzzled also by the scores of parcels in plain wrappers that began coming in to the old man before we sailed. It was not until much later that we would find out what they contained. Meanwhile, our destroyer had gone to sea again, protecting convoys across the North Atlantic to England. It was rough work. Icy gales battered ships, and ships were torpedoed almost every night. We had little sleep and much physical discomfort. Everyone drooped with fatigue. Tempers became edgy, and there were fights. Captain Stark was constantly on the bridge, smoking his pipe and watching everything carefully. Despite the fact that his clear blue eyes became bloodshot from exhaustion, and he stooped a bit from weariness, he remained calm and aloof. If he knew how the unholy K's were trying to destroy the ship's morale, he never mentioned it. It was their well-rendered ballads that did the dirty work. Everyone was afraid of these four bullies, but when they sang insidious songs about the ship's officers, the crew listened. Their lyrics were so catchy that a song rendered in the after-crew's washroom would be repeated all over the ship within a half hour. No officer has ever heard the four men sing, but the results of their music were uncomfortably apparent. The Unholy K's had one song about the hundreds of packages the captain had locked in the forward peak tank. The lyrics said that the boxes contained silk stockings, cigarettes, whiskey, drugs, and other black market goods the captain was going to sell in England. They depicted the captain becoming a millionaire and retiring to a mansion in New Hampshire as soon as the war was over. Well, the crew began asking questions. Why should the old man be hiding the parcels? Why had they been delivered with so much secrecy? It was even rumored that the old man was head of a black market cartel, and the cartons contained drugs stolen from Navy supply depots. But when the crew saw Captain Stark, tall, quiet, dignified, they knew in their hearts that the rumors were impossible. In mid-December, we shoved off from Newfoundland with another convoy. There were 62 ships in the group, many of them tankers, filled with high-octane aviation gasoline. Almost immediately, we ran into a gale, The ships wallowed and floundered among the mountainous waves. For nearly a week, we had nothing to eat but sandwiches, and it was impossible to sleep. On top of this misery, we received an emergency alert and intelligence that the largest Nazi submarine wolf pack ever assembled was shadowing our convoy. After a few days at sea, all grumbling and grousing stopped. We were too weary to do anything but stand watch, straining our eyes and ears for the enemy. Finally, the storm slackened and the submarines closed in. During the beginning of the second week, hardly a night went by without the sky lighting up with the explosions of torpedoed ships. Then, at sunrise, on the 25th of December, as we neared the southwest tip of Ireland, our protection arrived. Royal Navy planes. The seas calmed, and we all relaxed. For the first time in what had seemed ages, the men were able to get a hot meal and sleep. All hands, except those on watch, turned in thankfully, exhausted. Suddenly, at 9 o'clock on this Christmas morning, the boatswain's mate piped reveille. A wave of grumbling passed over the ship. We had all expected to be able to sleep in unless there was an attack. A few minutes later, Captain Stark's voice came over the loudspeaker. This is the captain speaking. Shipmates, I know you are tired and want to sleep, but today is Christmas. There are special surprise packages from your families. They have been unloaded from the forward peak tanks and have been distributed throughout the ship alphabetically. The news exploded through the ship. Men scrambled for their packages. Sailors sat all over the decks, cutting string, tearing paper, wiping away tears, and shouting to shipmates about what they had received. But the four unholy Ks found no presents. They stood together, watching the others sullenly. Christmas, said Koenig. It's only an excuse to get suckers to spend money. Don't show me your new watch, sneered Krakow to a young sailor who proudly held it up. If I need a new ticker, I'll buy me one. One happy kid came jigging up with a huge box of fudge. From my girl, he sang out. Now I see why the old man wanted her name and address. Hey, said Krakow, grabbing Kelly's arm. Didn't we give the old man our girls' names and addresses? Yeah, said Cratch, beginning to grin slyly. Rita Hayworth, Ginger Rogers, Lana Turner, and Paulette Goddard. Then how come we didn't get anything? Let's go see the old man. The unholy Kays, smiling evilly, went to the captain's cabin. Captain Stark, sir, said Krakow with mock respect. We got a complaint. Everybody on this ship got presents from the names and addresses they gave you. The captain looked at the four men gravely. Don't you think that's pretty nice? But we gave you names and addresses and we didn't get no presents. Oh, you didn't? Said the old man slowly. No, sir. Everyone but us. That's discrimination, sir. By gum, said the captain, standing up. There are four extra packages. Now I just wonder. He went to his bunk and pulled a blanket off a pile of parcels. There's one for me, hollered Kelly, surging forward. Captain Stark stood up to his full 6 feet and blocked the way. Reaching into the bunk, he handed out the packages to the four men, one at a time. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'll conduct Yuletide services for all hands. He went out to the bridge. The unholy Kays ripped the colored wrappings. Krakow couldn't open his fast enough and took his sheath knife to slash the ribbon. Inside the fancy box was a pair of knitted woolen gloves. He tried them on his big red hands. Gee, the right size. There was something else in the box. It was a picture of a shapely woman in a low-cut dress, and there was writing on it. Dear Joe Krakow, I knitted these gloves especially for you, because you are my best boyfriend in the U.S. Navy. I hope that they'll keep you warm, and that you'll have a wonderful Christmas wherever you may be, from your best gal, Rita Hayworth. Joe Krakow felt around his pockets for a handkerchief, but couldn't find one.
What did you guys get? He said, sniffling. Me? Said Koenig shrilly. I got a wallet and a picture of Paulette Goddard from Paulette Goddard. Kelly received a watch and an autographed picture from Ginger Rogers, and Cratch's present from Lana Turner was a gold fountain pen and a sentimentally inscribed photograph. The unholy case shuffled around to the bridge where Captain Stark, his Bible open, stood in front of the microphone. Krakow said, Captain, sir. Later, said the captain bluntly, without even turning. He switched on the loudspeaker, announced church services, and read the story of the nativity to all hands. Below, in the engine room, men listened. And in the chief's quarters, in the galley, in the mess compartments, throughout the ship, 250 sailors listened as the old man read the story of Jesus. When he finished, he said he hoped everyone would join him in singing a few carols. The unholy Kays pushed in on the captain.
Let us help you, sir,
Krakow said urgently. Well, this is not your type of song, the captain replied.
Please, sir, it's the least we can do. Lead the singing and all. Let this be our Christmas present to you, sir.
A Christmas present from me, mused the old man. Why, yes, we'd all appreciate having a choir for the occasion. What shall we start with? The four sailors looked at the old man, and then down at the photographs and presents clutched tightly under their arms. They gathered around the microphone. Krakow coughed. Then, in his deep bass voice, he boomed,
Shipmates, this is Koenig, Kelly, Cratch, and me, Krakow, four no-good bums. Today is Christmas, and we want to sing you a special ballad.
He paused and wiped his eyes and nose on his shirt sleeve. Krakow raised his hand like a symphony conductor, and the quartet began to sing. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright. The magic of the holy music spread. Everyone on the ship joined in. The helmsman and the officer of the deck put their throats to the Christmas ballad. Even Captain Elias Stark, the granite man from New Hampshire, moved into the quartet, inclined his head, and in reedy tenor swelled the song. Sleep in heavenly peace. Sleep in heavenly peace. The joyous music rose above the noise of the ocean and the destroyer's engines. During the third stanza, an enormous bird soared in from the low-hanging clouds and landed in the after rigging. It flapped its great wings and made noises as if it, too, were singing our Christmas ballad along with us. My shipmate said it was an albatross. But even though my eyes were filled with tears, I'd swear that it was an angel. Of course, that was many years ago when I was still a kid. But even then, I could recognize an angel when I saw one. As sure as my name's Joe Krakow.
What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthem sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Christian fear for sinners here. the silent word is pleading. Nail's spear shall pierce him through, the cross be borne for me, for you. Hail, hail the word made flesh, the babe, the son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold and myrrh, come peasant king to own him, the King of kings, salvation brings, then loving hearts enthrone him. Raise, raise the song on high, the virgin sings her lullaby. Joy, joy, for Christ is born, the babe, the son of Mary. This is Christ, the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the son of Mary.
It's been lovely to worship together this Wednesday evening. We are so glad to be doing life together this way. We invite you to join us for Sunday worship, the second Sunday in Advent, and then again, next Wednesday will be our second midweek Advent service. Pastor Lee, would you close us with prayer?
I would love to do that. Lord, thank you for this time that we've had together, and bless us as we go in the next few days. Be with us as you promised. And hear these words, Lord, from us. We thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.